Now, I see the Cherry Tree Lane as not too townified on one side of the park. And we'll get you a photograph of 50 Smith Street in order to see that the house is really quite like that, but it has more of a garden than my house has. But it might be useful and amusing to put it in as my house. Well, go on.
Well, it looks like he'll have to take over and hire a man such as he used to have, who knows how to control a real estate.
And here we put in something that we shall be able to refer to as a clue later on when Mr. Banks half guesses the truth that Mary Poppins had once been his nanny. Just a little something in the script. I'll help you with it later.
He telephones an advertisement to the London Times in which he lists the qualifications for an old-fashioned nanny at the Spare the Rod Spoiled Child School. We dissolve to the next morning. In the nursery, we find Jane and Michael looking out of their window at a long line of unattractive applicants. From their conversation, we learn that they are not unruly children at all. They decide to write their own advertisement.
What do they write? They call it a something, which I think is quite useful to recall. Ah, you've got a thing called the perfect nanny.
The composer's advertisement to a subtle rhythm pattern which develops into a melody, performed laboriously by Jane and Michael, Jane writing on the back of a large counter which is a picture of a Lancer painting of Don.
She goes on as though writing, if you want this choice position, with her tongue out, you see, then Michael says, you must be happy and cheerful all the time, even when you're angry. Then Jane writes, cheery disposition. Yes. Not like Katie Nanner, who's always cross and smelt like barley water.
The vision of this song, they enter the breakfast room and timidly present advertisements to the father by slipping it over his newspaper.
Let them peep round the edge of the newspaper, and they can't get in anywhere, you see. One goes round one side of the newspaper, the other goes round the other, they can't get in. Mr. Banks is poring over the financial columns. But father, it was the advertisement. I put the advertisement in now. You go and behave yourself, you see.
Yes, sir.
Then somebody goes on reading.
As the maid pours coffee over the top of the paper,
she informs Mr. Banks that there's a long queue of applicants waiting outside.
The children leave the room. We see a mysterious wind take the scraps up the chimney and up to the sky.
Another wind blows one of the nanny's suitcases in her pipe.
And they all go running after their belongings.
Yes, their belongings, their purses.
Their purses and their suitcases.
Suitcases,
their
cloaks.
And they're fluttering after all their belongings.
Because that is a human thing to happen. That something has been caused by Mary Poppins' entrance, though we don't know about it yet. And it links up with her.
The children's amazement and excitement increases as they see a figure appear in the sky.
It's coming this way. It's not a bird. What is it? Jane! It's a person! Look!
Now we cut to the breakfast room where Mr. Banks sits aside his newspaper.
The maid has come back again. Please, sir. Well, what is it? Oh, they've arrived. Very good, Ellen. Tell them I'll receive them in my study. You may all come in now, but why don't...
They're shocked. The solitary figure of Mary Poppins standing on the doorstep with the children's patched together advertisement in one hand.
Good morning. Now we come to my notes here, my typewritten notes. It is integral to the book and to the story in whatever form is presented that Mary Poppins should never be impolite to anybody. We get the comedy out of this grave, quiet, polite person through which all the strange magic happens. He asks her a few things, you see, because you say later on he thought at the beginning there was something wrong with her. And it would be very good if he said, and what was your last position? Seems to have seen her, but we don't say so. She answers a family of repute, sir. And where before that were the family of even greater repute, sir? Her carpet bag before her, she slides up the banister. And the children turn to each other and say, she went up. Then there is the question of the tape.
She reads that Jane is over-imaginative and inclined to exaggerate.
Yeah.
And Michael is noisy, stubborn, etc. And inclined to dawdle. And Mary measures herself.
Just as I thought, practically perfect. Mary Poppins comes with a deep intent, and we must ask ourselves in this play what she comes for. And my idea is, and probably you'll agree with me, she comes to find something for herself as well as to bring something. And the children, after the tape thing, they find that this magic thing is true and they have seen her. And why did you come? And she says, I came to find something. She turns and says, you go along now.
She turns and sets her carpet bag on her bed in the sleeping alcove in a corner of the nursery. And then she starts to unpack, as Michael asks.
But you haven't told us. You haven't told us what your name is.
And Mary things are
Mary clings to the looking glass, and the looking glass answers. She dumps things out of her bed, and they magically arrange themselves in the closet and on the dresser.
As you can see, this song, as much action, takes place as she sings this little song. So here she starts to sing when Michael says, but you haven't told us what your name is. You know, and
yes.
she very obliviously starts to unfold.
What my name is? What difference should that make?
I named a name, a chair, that's a chair. A mirror is a mirror. A rug's a rug, a floor's a floor. Could anything be clearer? Please, the children go over and buy and say, it's empty.
Look, they look inside the carpet bag, they say, and they say, but it's empty. And all those things came up.
Right, and at that point, then the mirror starts to sing, and Mary
mirror sings the melody in reverse. In
oh, that's a good idea.
So at any rate, the mirror goes like this. And Mary says, depending on who wears it,
for joy or for
depending on who shares it, for everyone there is a name, for every name a someone. And Michael's he, and Jane is she, and of all the ones that one might be, I'd rather be no one but me, because I'm Mary Poppins.
That's right.
And then she says, "Mary spot, and off we go."